education for girls as well as boys. Often not recognized, Rousseau addresses the education of girls in the latter part of Emile. As already addressed, the greater portion of Emile is dedicated to the education of a boy, but in the second half of Emile, and specifically in the fifth book, Rousseau also addresses the education for a girl. The second place education of girls addressed in Emile is discussed by John Darling in his article, Child-Centered, Gender-Centered. Like Emile, the curriculum Rousseau proposed for girls is portrayed through a fictitious girl named Sophie. The similarities stop with Sophie being the prototypical girl. Unlike the freedoms bestowed on Emile, which Darling states, unlimited scope for play, not to be pressured into studying, and not to be directly taught, Sophie is quite the opposite. Rousseau believes that Sophie's education should be very specific and regimented for preparation in life of a housewife. The prescribed education for Sophie to be patient and submissive. Rousseau's rationale, as explained by Darling, is girls are not the same as boys. The female as more modest, more cunning, more understanding of the opposite sex, and more skilled in personal relationships. As can be seen in Emile and reaffirmed by Darling, girls are able to disseminate understanding for themselves as opposed to boys who must take their time and gain understanding through experience. Darling addresses the further claim that boys and girls are complementary, completing one another's shortcomings. The first issue comes with Rousseau's presupposition that girls have a singular occupational purpose, to be a good housewife. Context and mindset of the time aside, the prescribed education of girls allows no room for girls to explore any other option than being a housewife. Rousseau also holds the conjecture, as Darling writes, a girl's education is to be conducted in the light of the destiny which her nature determines. In other words, a boy's vocation could be anything, but a girl's only have one, as a housewife. The invariability of the vocation of girls limits Rousseau's suggestion for their education to only that which would aid in the mastery of the housewife. The second criticism pertains to Rousseau's assumption that girls and boys are complementary. The assumption girls and boys being complementary neglects consideration of same-sex relationships. Rousseau's assumption suggests heteronormativity, or that girls and boys are complementary, which is inconsiderate of those who see girls or boys and boys relationships as complementary. This again could be relegated to a concern of different times, but the consideration of such implications are necessary to consider for those who may see this as offensive or excluding. A further problematic issue proposed because of Rousseau's work is the way he positions Sophia's education as a secondary of Emile's. Rousseau makes no secret of the perceptions that women are to obey men. The obedience to men translates into the way that Rousseau casts Sophia's education. Darling, 1986, explains, in procedural terms, it is significant that Emile's development is explained in its own terms while Sophia's nature is explained in terms of how it differs from Emile's. Rousseau's establishment of boys and girls' education on the basis that men's destiny is uncertain, whereas women will always assume the role of the wife, mother, and homemaker. The assumption that Darling addresses for Rousseau's perception of education and those that can be extrapolated in one way or another provokes controversy because of its single-minded considerations. Rousseau's education for Emile and Sophia suggests a bifurcated education that is exclusive to those who assume Rousseau's perspective of one education for girls and one education for boys. The dichotomy that Rousseau suggests neglects the girls that may be better educated along with boys, the boys that may be better educated with girls, or the myriad of combinations. At any rate, the limited dichotomy that Rousseau proposes for education excludes much of what is being considered for for in an education for individuals. The Great Infractions, Rousseau, 2007, stated in a meals pertaining to the perception of women is, a woman is worth less than a man. Not to excuse the perception of the time, it is obvious that the belief is no longer held in today's society. The struggles women have had to face because of such beliefs are unforgivable and therefore disqualifies much, if not all, education for girls that Rousseau suggests. Although the recognition of women's equality to men has come a long way since Rousseau's time, it must be recognized that blatantly oppositional professions against women's equality has an effect. There may be those that are quick to recognize the negative implications of such assertions and disregard or draw attention to what such damaging proclamations can have. Yet there are those who do not have the strength to handle such derogatory assertions. There are also those who are less educated or blatantly aggressive that may be influenced by such archaic proclamations. Religion and feminism. Feminist scholars have criticized Rousseau's perspectives addressing nature and education of women. Martina Ruder, 2014, argues that the perception of Rousseau has been misconstrued. Most of these criticisms pertain to Rousseau as a biological reductionist and an essentialist. Ruder, 2014, addresses the misconstructions by focusing on one particular critic's assessment in her article. Like a fanciful kind of half-being, Mary Wollstonecraft's criticism of Jean-Jacques Rousseau, the deriving consideration that Ruder, 2014, confronts in Wollstonecraft is Wollstonecraft had a stronger belief in the normativity of nature than did Rousseau. Wollstonecraft concentrated on Rousseau's distinction between physical and moral order. Ruder used Wollstonecraft's concentration to question the 21st century feminist assumption that social constructionism is preferable to a normative conception of nature. Ruder's criticism of Wollstonecraft's criticism is provoked by Wollstonecraft's broad scope of philosophical disagreements pertaining to civilization, religion, and morals. Much of Wollstonecraft's assumptions are based on the idea that present status is not an indicator of what things can be. The belief that indicators of today are imperfect, Ruder seats in Wollstonecraft's theology. Ruder clarifies, Wollstonecraft's thought of God is ultimately to provide reason with a universal foundation. Wollstonecraft's theology is relevant because it pertains to the inseparability between it and its power to guide human actions and ergo civilization. The theology differs between Wollstonecraft and Rousseau. Ruder, 2014, distinguishes Wollstonecraft represents those who seek God's guidance in human perfectibility. Rousseau argues that human freedom and the attempt at perfectibility are primarily a source of moral evil. Opposing Rousseau's pessimistic thought, Wollstonecraft defends human freedom and God's aim as a similar direction. The similar direction is the reconciling argument against Rousseau's dichotomous perspectives between the natural man and the citizen. Instead of the will of humanity being an opposing force from God's will, it is God's will that humanity pursues its will. The argument pertains to Wollstonecraft's criticism of theology to refute Rousseau's perspective of women being predestined to the life of the housewife, as humanity's will is God's will, and therefore women are not predestined for a singular station, but as God's will suggests, it is the woman's will that should be satisfied. Reason and will are the tensions that emerges as Ruder's negotiation between Wollstonecraft's and Rousseau's. Wollstonecraft uses will and reason to argue to paint an optimistic perspective between nature and society, whereas Rousseau uses will and reason to paint a negative one. The positive perspective is, as recently explained, to use the will and reason to diffuse prejudice. Rousseau argues that reason makes inequality possible. Both perspectives are based upon imagination, which allows for the casting of relative ideals. Rousseau proposes that the natural man does not possess imagination because they have all they desire, suggesting that imagination is an adaptation of what is needed or could be. Therefore, the education of a male works to stifle the imagination in order to better understand his faculties, suppressing the division between what is achievable and what is not.
Do more, do better.